and gentlemen, I, student manager Nidhi Gupta, is feeling honored to introduce a towering personality amongst us, Mr. Santosh Panicker. Mr. Santosh Panicker, sir, is a visionary HR professional with over 22 years of rich and varied experience in human resource. Sir has been awarded several awards and accolades for HR leadership. Best strategy in line with business goals and talent management at World HRD Congress. He is a winner of award for significant achievement in HR excellence by Confederation of Indian Industry CII and Chief Human Resource Officer CHRO award by World HRD Congress and have also won several awards. Sir has completed his graduation in BCom Accountancy from University of Pune and also did Masters in Personnel Management and Diploma in Labor Laws and Labor Welfare from IMS Ahmednagar. A startup specialist has established several startups across IT, FMCG, retail, automobile with Fortune 500 brands. Sir has been instrumental in establishing 7 startups across IT, manufacturing, and retail. He has set up Sears IT Captive, which included 3 subsidiaries, 2 within India and 1 global in 4 years' time. Sir coined CARE framework to empower associates for career progression, designed innovative assessment centers, and abolished bell curve way back in 2015. His intense efforts and experience also exist in organization restructuring and was part of 2 main restructuring exercises and transitioned into format-based organization for 40 group companies comprising of more than 25,000 employees. Sir is also an integration expert and wear the hat of 3 successful integration of the career. Sir has signed 3 cost-neutral wage settlements in the career and has also been instrumental in running several signature CSR programs in organizations like Swachh Bharat Abhiyan and many more. Sir has drove PCMM Level 3 certification for Sears India, first company in India to get this certification within 5 years of its operation, and championed several quality practices showcased at the national level. He is instrumental in designing innovative recruitment practices that led to savings of more than $300 million in 6 years and kept manpower cost under $8 per hour, and also designed cost-effective resource management that led to the saving of operation cost amounting to $500,000. With extreme focus on leadership development, he has formulated leadership development framework and introduced DDI for leadership assessments. Now, I would request Mr. Santosh Panicker, sir, to please come and share his words of wisdom. The floor is all yours, sir. Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
Great, the energy is great out here. So first and foremost, I would like to thank the management of this institute for having me here. It's always good to give it back to the students. You know, it all started, you know, I was one of you almost 25 years back. And today I am here to address my experience, my sharing, my learnings, and the learning continues, okay? So what you're going to hear in next an hour, I think we have got, 75 minutes or 90 minutes, whatever it is. I'll try to share with you my experience, okay? But before that, how many of you are from Pune? And how many of you are, so most of them are from outstation, right? Okay, hi, Akhila, so I can see you there. Great. So what I'm trying to share here is, as you heard, I have overall 24 years of experience. But then at the same time, what I'm trying to do here is for each of the company that I have been associated with, I'm trying to share with you in terms of what have been my key takeaways from those companies. And I'll share some examples so that, you know, we are trying to make it context-based. That's fine with all of you? Great. Okay, the first company that I have worked with is Phenolex Plastro Plason. There's a brief about this company. That company is primarily into drip irrigation system. It was the first Indo-Israeli company set up at near Talegaon. So my role there, I joined the company from campus, okay? And as most of the students would be, very excited to be part of Phenolex Group at that point of time, which was one of the greatest brands in Pune. Phenolex is again a Pune-based company promoted by, the promoters are from Pune. And of course, Phenolex cables, Phenolex pipes, and all of these are their popular brands. And of the late, you will see that they are sponsoring a lot of IPL teams and all of that, okay? So when I started this career, when I started my career with Phenolex, I joined them as a personal and admin assistant. And over a period of time, I got promoted. My role there was to assist the personal department head. So that time it was called personal and admin department, okay? HR really started kicking in late 90s in some of the companies. So there my role was primarily to assist the department head who was setting up the company in building up the HR systems, policies, processes. And my job was to really attend all meetings what he's into and take notes. At the same time, he used to ask me to draft the HR policies and I was completely blank. I did not know how to go about it because I thought, yeah, I never learned about this in college. But that's what the companies do. When you join them, they will try to put you into the pool. They want to see whether you are able to swim on your own or not. And it's very important. So don't be afraid, first and foremost, because you will be put under situations which you are not used to. You will say that I am just out of college. I don't have the experience. But then if you work under some managers, they want you to go through that situation. What it means is you are in a swimming pool and you are supposed to swim. You need to reach out to colleagues. You need to reach out to your alumni networks. Try to see how differently the other companies are practicing this. So do a benchmarking. So all of that was a learning as part of my earlier career. So even, you know, my boss was also responsible for administration department and initially he used to ask me to go and audit the vehicles which belong to the company. He used to ask me to ensure, to visit the canteen and ensure that, you know, the canteen had hygienic food and all the safety factors were taken in from a food and hygiene perspective. Now, after coming from a college doing my management, it had gone into my head and I said, have I done my management course just to do this administrative work and carry out all of this inspection? But actually later, over a period of time, I realized what my boss was asking me to do is, he was ensuring that I understand or I dirty my hands right from scratch and I am personally there to monitor things on ground. You know, so first and foremost, very important thing for all of you to remember is, when you're getting into any company, any role, ensure you are dirtying your hands, you are there on ground. And those were the key learnings for me. At the same time, when we were ramping up, because it was a startup, so we had to hire workers and all of that, I was asked to help my production managers to draft, you know, some tests so that all the workers who were at, or the potential candidates for the workers' position, they were going through this assessment. And I really struggled for that because I was not mentally ready. And it took a while for me, it took a lot of time for me to really understand all of these nuances and really perform. But actually, if you identify right mentors in the company, because there are many colleagues who would come across and who would help you out. So I think what is important is you need to reach out. The important takeaway while doing all of this, because when you are setting up these systems, processes, what the management is expecting from you is, because you are fresh from the college, so they expect that your academic base is strong. And that's where they want to see that you are bringing those learnings into the day-to-day operations of the company. So what it means is, now that you're going to spend your 2 years in your management courses, ensure that you need to have a vision. If I join a startup, how am I going to, if I'm making a career in marketing, or be it finance, or be it HR, how are you going to ensure that your technical capabilities, which is your academics, is perfect? So try to correlate it that, okay, 2 years down the line, if I join a startup, how am I going to manage this situation? Then there are companies which are at different phase of life. Some are startups, some are matured, some are struggling to grow. Then there is already mergers and acquisitions. And you might find in one of these companies that you have been selected and you are given a task of really helping the HODs or working with your colleagues, senior colleagues, in managing those tasks. So try to relate whatever you are doing or whatever your academics, whatever you are going through, try to relate to different phases of the company, because that will really help you to be ready by the time you are coming out of the campus. Because I hope you are aware that almost 5.5 million graduates pass out every year, okay? And of that, only 19% of them are employable. So what is that will differentiate you from others is the question that you need to ask yourself. Are you clear so far?
Yes, sir.
So what is important? My first company taught me, you need to ensure that your hands are dirty. You need to dirty your hands, whatever you call it, from that perspective. At the same time, brilliant basics. So what I mean by brilliant basics here is being an technical expert. When I say technical expert, don't go by the word engineering or something. Here, technical means if you are a finance guy, you should know your financial technicalities, okay? So what it means is your cash flow, your profit and loss statements, your balance sheets and all of that. When it comes to HR, it's like managing the life cycle, R to R. Recruitment to retirement, or recruitment to resignation, recruitment to redeployment. So managing the life cycle. So it starts from recruitment, HR operations, talent management, L&D. Some HR departments also manage the admin function. Some HR departments also manage the corporate communications. So you should know the technical aspects of all these sub-functions within HR. If it is marketing, you need to know all the latest terms. And nowadays, social media is a big thing. So what it means is you should be able to correlate all of that. And I'm happy to share here, the government of India is really working with the corporates to see that how we can really improve the syllabus. And they are having different committees and forums whereby they are inviting all these corporates to really ensure that we are enhancing the syllabus and we are ensuring that the students who are passing out are really employable. So I give you that percentage of 19%. It's a scary situation, but I think the government has already recognized this and they are working hard to interact with the institutes, they are interacting with the corporates, and there are different committees and forums which has been created to ensure that we are really working on the syllabus. So as I said, you know, my Finolex journey was all about, it was a startup, it was a manufacturing unit, agriculture sector, setting up the HR function. But what they were looking out for me is, hey, you have come from academics, so at least you ensure that the brilliant basics from an academic standpoint continues to be there. But I struggled there, so that's one takeaway. I don't want you all to really, again, when you pass out after 2 years and we are asked to, when you are asked to do some policy drafting and all, it should not happen that you have forgotten what you learnt in first year or second year. The subjects would be quite different, but what is imperative is you have those things properly chalked out, and as I said, correlated to the different phases of the company. The other thing is customer orientation, because what happened is I was formulating the policy and all, and then I was formulating this questionnaire for the candidates who were being interviewed for the workers' position. I formulated the question in English, and later I realized that my customers are all who do not understand English, right? Workers, most of the workers do not understand English. So I had to really reach out to the engineers in the plant who would, change the language. So they converted this questionnaire into Marathi. So that was one of the learnings, because there was this D-Day and I had prepared this very proudly after struggling and taking help from many of my seniors. I came out with this questionnaire for the various tests and I showed it to my boss and he said, boss, this is not done. You need to know who your customers are.
So in this case, my internal customers or my external customers, the candidates, were workers who were not able to really read in English, right? So they wanted it to be, the questionnaires to be in the local language. So what it also means is, please try to understand the customer, the end customer who is going to see this policy or your process, and try to see that, try to see from his or her lens, whether that person can read this questionnaire or not. So that was a key learning for me. So as I said, brilliant basics, customer orientation, and then being hands-on. So that's where I have written, you know, one needs to dirty your hands, because it's important that you do it yourself. So what it means is, I give you this example of administration department, where I was supposed to audit, go and inspect the vehicles, when it came to canteen, visit those canteens and look at the hygiene factor and all of that. And so somewhere it had got into my head, hey, I'm an MBA guy or an MPM guy, so I'm not supposed to do it. But then my boss wanted me to do, because that's where your mentors come in. Whenever they are sharing, or whenever they are asking you, or whenever they are assigning you some task, please keep in mind they have certain bigger picture, and it would be good for you to know that. Because the best thing what we are seeing over a period of time is, the new generation wants to know today whatever they are doing, how it is impacting, they want to see the bigger picture, and that's good thing. So what it means is, try to know more and ask more questions when you are getting into the campuses. So my second company was Grupo Antolin. The earlier name was Auto Interiors. It was a tripartite joint venture company, and basically three multinationals, because 1991 the Indian economy had opened up. Then the Prime Minister of India, Mr. Manmohan Singh, had opened up the doors for foreign companies to come in, and that time a lot of OEMs came into India. So Ford, Fiat, because I was picked up by Grupo Antolin, or the Auto Interiors, which was the earlier name, they were the dedicated suppliers to these companies. So when this OEM came, a lot of ancillary units from Europe and US followed. And I was lucky to be part of that because of my earlier experience. You know, this company got to know that, you know, there's this junior guy there who has been instrumental in really formulating and personally writing those policies and documentation. So actually your past work gets you the second appointment, or your past efforts really help you with the new opportunities. So in my second assignment, it was again a startup, but it was a tripartite company, a tripartite joint venture. So in a joint venture, there are multiple stakeholders, okay? And basically, at that point of time, when I started my career, there was hardly any computers. In Finolex, there was only two computers. One was with the chief executive officer and one was with the finance head. And that time, I was struggling to learn computers. When I went to the second company, which was an MNC, all of a sudden, there was computers all over. And I was struggling really to work on computers. And I had to really take personal tuitions, and I had to join some courses outside to really equip myself or create the computer awareness and learn a lot of stuff. So while on one side, I joined the second company, which was my second company in the career, I'm supposed to help the company scale up the operation, and I'm struggling with the new tools that are in the market. So the one learning there has been, you know, I need to keep a tab of what's happening in the external world, and I need to sharpen my saw. Okay, I continuously need to learn, because these are new technologies, and if I don't adapt, I would be out of the marketplace. So in my second assignment, again, since it was three companies, all of a sudden, all the three stakeholders started asking financial numbers and all of that, which I was completely blank. And over a period of time, you'll realize, and there are discussions in different HR forums, you know, why HR is not part of the board. Because normally, if you really ask the CEOs and all, when they ask any numbers from HR, be it your manpower numbers, be it the various diversity numbers, be it your cost, HR is never accurate. So what happens, the CEO then typically turns his, he goes to the finance department, and they are able to give you the accurate numbers. So that was one of the learnings in my second company, that whenever we are in HR department, we need to own up our department, and whatever data we are sharing with our management, we need to stick by it. So we need to be very confident about the numbers that we are sharing, and that's very, very key. So while most of you, you know, in our school days, college days, maths is one subject we want to avoid, but when you get into corporates, because we are in a business where the ultimate aim of the business, the primary aim is to make profit. So you should know some financial numbers, okay? Because in a startup, naturally everything boils down from a business plan. And as an HR, you are supposed to work on the manpower numbers. You are supposed to work on the manpower cost. You are supposed to come with a cost to company figures and all of that. So keep that in mind, because that's very, very important for all of you. As I said, you know, take some notes, because ensure that during your 2 years, you are going through these things and you are able to understand what comprises cost to company for an employee, okay? And what is a business plan? So within a business plan, what are the numbers that really influence HR? So that has been my learning in my second company. Besides that, what happened is basically the tripartite, you know, the partners were not gelling well. And all of a sudden, we saw that there was friction between three companies. And then one company was trying to fudge the number because the other company was trying to take over. So the tripartite company was, the three companies were that were involved were, one was Indian, one was Italian, and one was Spanish. Finally, the Spanish company took over. However, when the merger and acquisition was happening, in this case it was a merger, there was this due diligence which was carried out, and I could see some of my colleagues were fudging the data. And that's one thing that you should ensure, that you know, ethics is very key, and you have seen most of the organizations going down the drain in the recent past because of ethics issue. Have you heard of any examples? Satyam, okay, great. Enron. So basically, now if you really see, and I was talking to the faculties in the room, because nowadays the board of directors are really afraid to sign any board or any balance sheets, because they want to ensure that the company is compliant and ethical in its practices. So that's one of the takeaways, because when the due diligence was going on, really I could see some of my colleagues fudging the data and giving wrong data. And you know, in an audit over a period of time, these things come out. So what is important is to be ethical in your work practices. So basically the key learnings for me at Auto Interiors or Grupo Antolin, which was this, the earlier name was Auto Interiors, was ensuring that you are having the financial numbers in place. So naturally, one of the competencies that you should really work upon is your financial acumen. The second one is basically sharpen your saw. As I said, you know, while in that year, the computers had come up and I was not really ready to work on computers. So what it means is you need to see what are the new technologies coming in your, in the global work, global workplace, and ensure that you are imbibing those skills or learning those skills. Otherwise, you will be out of the market, okay? And then the last but most important is about the ethics, which I shared with you. Because you might come across situations, like I being in admin department, I was monitoring the transport vehicles. You know, you have these taxis which are run in your company. So our company was in Ranjangaon, so it's almost 50 kilometers from Pune. And the vehicle goes up and down several times. And at the end of the day, as a personal and admin officer, you're supposed to sign and verify the log sheets. So you will come across some contractors who would say, sir, aap increase kar do kuch, you know, I'll try to manage you. So you need to, you will come across these situations, as especially, I'll be sharing more of HR admin examples, so excuse me on that. But what it means is you need to ensure your ethical and your integrity, because that's one of the values that I think all of you should hold up to. And in integrity, it is either yes or no. There's nothing in between, okay? So keep that in mind. So you will come across a lot of situations where there are external parties who will influence you to fudge the data, to share, to, you know, share wrong informations and all of that. But please ensure this will come and haunt you over a period of time. So being ethical is very, very important. Integrity is one of the key values that you should imbibe. The next company from there, I moved on to Saint-Gobain Glass. Saint-Gobain had acquired a very old, 25-year-old company in Bursary. And I was asked to really the French management. Saint-Gobain is a French multinational. They are world number one or two in any of the categories that they are in. So their vision is very clear. Whatever business they are in, they need to be either world number one or two. Okay? And they had acquired this business, as I said, you know, in 1991, the economy had opened up in India and a lot of companies had come in. So Saint-Gobain also came in few years later, and they, rather than setting up a new company, they acquired a company. That company was earlier known by the name Maharashtra Safety Glass. They had completed the whole transformation process, but then they wanted to implement the best practices. And so what happened is, you have a company which is 25 year old, workers don't want to change. We had a situation where all the production managers, what we call the first line of management, were in union. And the French company was against time to really improve the productivity, because they are world leaders and they wanted to supply to all the OEMs in India. But due to the employees who were rigid and not ready to accept any change, we had to really go through a lot of challenges. And there, because I was working very closely with the plant head, because I was the unit HR manager there. So we had to not only manage the internal stakeholders, which is the production officers or production engineers who were in part of the union, but also the external union, because Rajan Nair was the union leader there. So I don't know how many of you have heard about Rajan Nair. So Telco in Pune, you have heard about Telco, Tata Motors today. That company had never witnessed a strike. And during it was in 90s that Tata's had this strike, and Rajan Nair was the union leader there, and it impacted the industry big time. Okay, and he was the same union leader in our company, and he was actually not ready to accept change, and there were a lot of conditions that he had put, and really the management struggled, because the first line of management was with the production engineers were also part of the union. So we had to really work hard to first and foremost get the production engineers out from the union, because they are the first line of management, what we call. So when you are engaging or when you are driving any change, I think there is a lot of work. There is engagement with the internal stakeholder, external stakeholder. You need to know the labor laws quite well. When you are signing any wage settlements, you need to ensure, you know, what are the various provisions of law and all of that. And those topics are covered in the syllabus. Unfortunately, we don't pay much attention during our educational or during our academics. And to be frank, like, I have struggled that. Because, you know, when I joined this company and when I was asked to look at different sections, first and foremost, I was struggling to refer to various labor laws. Then I realized there were no books in the company. So I had to rush to Pune city and pick up those books. And that time advocates, you know, we didn't have mobile at that time. That was the year when it was just launched. During that time it was just launched, and only few people in the management team had it. So we had to really run to the city, pick up those books and all of that. But what it meant is, you know, I had not done my homework well, and I had to really struggle to refer to these labor laws and all. What I would request you is, you during your next 2 years, definitely you are going to learn about labor laws. You should know, you know, how the various, you don't need to by heart the sections. Okay, what is important is to know what laws are applicable for a particular company. If it's a manufacturing company, the laws are different. If it is a company registered under Shop and Establishment Act, the laws are different. So whenever you get into any company, from an HR perspective, and as I said, you know, I'll be giving you more of HR example, but you all should know in terms of how this company is registered, who are the board of directors, partners, because that's where the HR role comes in. Because HR and finance are the conscious keepers of the company. And it's very imperative that from a labor law standpoint, HR ensures compliance. Unfortunately, most of the companies have outsourced their compliance to, the vendors like Team Lease or Randstad and all of those companies. Nothing bad against it, but what I mean is, you all should know, because when you grow up in your career and when you are accountable, you know, that works. So as an head HR, your compliance would be managed by somebody else, but at the end of the day, the accountability would be with you. So one of the key takeaways for you is, whichever company you need to get into, or whichever company you plan to get into, ensure that you know under what, you know, whether it's a private limited, public limited, whether it is registered under Factories Act, whether it is registered under Bombay Shop Establishment Act, and then try to get into the compliance fees, compliance piece first. Try to come out with a compliance calendar, be it whether the PF Act is applicable, whether the ESIC Act is applicable, Labor Welfare Fund, Employment Exchange, all of that. So there are actually today, because of Google, I think a lot of information is available at a click of button. And that's very, very imperative for you, that you understand whichever company you work for, what are the various compliances, be it from a financial standpoint or from HR standpoint, you need to ensure that you are aware of that. Are you clear? Great. So some of the key learnings at Saint-Gobain has been, you know, change management. Because during a change management, first and foremost, the leadership team needs to be aligned to the vision of the company, what this change is being proposed. And all of them have to walk the talk, have to be aligned to that purpose. And then there needs to be a clear-cut program that needs to be done. There are various change management models which are available. And I think over a period of time, and we always say change is constant. You would heard of it, right? And that's very, very important, because let's say tomorrow you are picked up by some of the company after 2 years, and you are part of a core team which is supposed to drive change. So as a student, naturally the core committee would expect you to share your theoretical inputs there. So would you be ready to share that inputs? Can you recommend certain change management models? So ask this question to yourself, because you know you will come across many companies who would come for hiring, but when you are able to really, during the interview process, impress upon the panel, you know, what are the topics and what are your strengths, and how you know how a company operates and how ready you are to contribute to the growth of that company, I think that will make a big difference. And definitely, as I said, amongst the other candidates who are appearing, you would stand out. So try to make a habit, because change is constant irrespective of what companies you get into. So one of my learnings have been, you know, I really had to struggle with the change management stuff. And that is something that you all should ensure. You should know, because when you pass out from the campus and when you join any corporate, they are not expecting you to lead teams and all, but they are expecting you to be brilliant in the academics, and they expect you to bring in the academics part into whatever they are driving there. So ensure in this next 2 years, whatever you are learning, you are ensuring that you take it to the companies and you are really able to implement and contribute in your own ways. The other thing, as I said, you know, it was all about external orientation. Again, in Saint-Gobain, as I said, the unions were, there was internal unions and external unions. So when you are signing a wage settlement, again, the relevant market condition, the industry what you are in, all of that needs to be taken care of. And it's important that not only look at your internal company, but you should also look at what's happening around. And nowadays we are working in a global village, what we call. So there would be teams which is operating in India. Some of them would be in Australia, some of them would be in Europe, some of them would be in US. So what it means is you need to ensure what's happening in different geographies, and that's what we call external orientation. And in this company, what I meant is, because we were signing a wage settlement for the automobile sector for this company, I had to benchmark what was happening in different automobile companies within Pimpri Chinchwad. And that is the external benchmarking practice what we had to carry out. So those were the key learnings, because I was not ready for that when I started. But then I had to pick up and I had to really push myself hard to really imbibe those skills. The next company what I joined was Whirlpool of India, one of the largest consumer durables company. This plant was in Ranjangaon. And I was asked to head the unit HR. My role there was to really work upon the development programs for engineers, the middle management development programs. besides implement a lot of Six Sigma practices or lean practices, what is the quality practices. So it was really to work with cross-functional teams and ensure that we are providing relevant training to the workers and engineers so that our product had very low quality issues. Okay, zero quality and all of that was something that I learned there. So the quality practices, because even though you would be in a different function, but in each company you will come across different cross-functional teams where you need to volunteer and implement whatever is the mission of that cross-functional team. So Whirlpool was really, that time LG had entered into India, and actually there was very fierce competition between LG and Whirlpool, and that's where a lot of initiatives plant, a lot of 5S practices or the quality practices was introduced in Whirlpool plant, which I was instrumental in running across the company. At the same time, I was managing the union, and we were also doing a lot of social CSR activities proactively. So one thing what I learned in Whirlpool is, you know, how you can really go back to the society through CSR initiatives and engage with external stakeholders. So as an HR, there is always opportunity for you to not only engage with internal stakeholders, there are other external stakeholders, be it the government officials, be it the local villagers, if it the plant or your unit is somewhere outside. And this gives you a lot of opportunity to engage with different stakeholders. And you should, over a period of time, you come across whether you are able to influence these stakeholders or not. And that's one skill that I picked up there, where it was more about influencing the workers on the workers in the plant, influencing the engineers, because these drives or these cross-functional committees that we had rolled out, each one of them had their own targets to really implement these practices across the plant. It was a mammoth task to be completed in record time, and that too without ensuring reduction in production and all of that. So it was very, very important to really work with the cross-functional team there. And basically some of the things that I learned there was, you know, effective communication. As I said, when you are driving too many cross-functional activities within the company, you need to manage different stakeholders. So in this case, I had to engage with the workers, we had to engage with the engineers, and at the same time, we had to submit reports to the management. So you are dealing with three different tiers of management, and it's very important to ensure that you are communicating very effectively and ensuring that the message is uniform and consistent all across. The other thing is stakeholder management. As I said, you know, when you're working in manufacturing units especially, you're not only dealing with internal stakeholders, you have to deal with unions, which might be external. At the same time, you have to deal with government officials. At the same time, you would also be dealing with various forums. You know, there are CII forums where your company would be part of that, and you need to go and share your practices or be part of certain discussions which is happening in those forums. So what I'm trying to share is, while you are, you know, let's say if you are in HR, don't restrict yourself only to your vertical. At times, when you mature in the company, while skills are important at a junior level, but when you grow up the ladder, it is the competencies that you need to pick up. And what I'm sharing with you is, you know, if you see my career, in my third company itself, I was asked to deal with external stakeholders and all of that. And you need to ensure when you're communicating, you're clear about the corporate communication policy, because certain things cannot be shared with external stakeholders. There would be media who might try to check and take some information from you. Because as I said in my earlier part of this thing, that in some companies, the corporate communication is managed by HR. So you need to be very sensitive while sharing information to any external parties. Okay, so that's something that you need to keep in mind. So from Whirlpool, I was picked up by my ex-boss who joined Dabur, and my assignment was in Nepal. And I don't know how many of you know the history. Nepal was actually going through a lot of political unrest, and there was this Maoist movement at that point of time which had picked up, and it was disrupting the country. And I was given this offer to join them. I was given the charge of country HR manager. Naturally, the designation was attractive. I was informed that, you know, I'll be the country head managing the corporate office. There were two plants, and there were a lot of tea estates, they had picked up lot of plantation hills and all of that. So it was a great role. And my parents asked me to really look at the political situation and take a decision. But then, you know, given that I looked at the role, I looked at the title, I looked at the compensation, and I said, no, everything is okay. You know, I'm not reading too much what's happening in that country, because the media is not covering too much, and I think it's pretty much there. But actually, if you see internally, I was more excited about the role, about the compensation being offered. So I went there and I was given this role, which was quite exciting. I started working on the policies, processes. One day I happened to, that was 2 months down the line, I was in my plant in Birganj, which is near to the India border. And all of a sudden, the mouse dropped a bomb there. I just, you know, it was a life-threatening episode for me. And somehow we struggled, most of our employees struggled to get out of the plant. And, you know, it was so shocking for me, because there was no casualty, but there were a couple of bombs which were dropped in our plant. But imagine the story, what would be the plight, because I was alone there and my family was in India. They were shocked to hear that there was a bomb blast in the company, and literally we escaped that blast. And my family said, nothing doing, you come back to India, you know. But you know why I picked up that job? Because of the title, because of the compensation. Personally, I had not done my due diligence thoroughly. So one thing that you need to keep in mind is, when you are picking up any assignment, when you are picking up any role in any company, you might come across situations where the title, the compensation might be very attractive, okay? But you need to carry out your personal due diligence. So I worked in that company hardly for 3 months, because it was a life-threatening episode and I had not done my due diligence. In spite of inputs given by my father, I ignored that input. And he had asked me to carry out the due diligence to check with the guys who are working there if really the situation is okay. So what I'm trying to share here is, during your career, there would be attractive offers that may come your way. There would be attractive compensations. But do your due diligence personally. Don't go by hearsay. Arre, usne bataya tha mujhe, so I just went by his word. I had done that mistake. Okay? So what I'm trying to share here is more of my learnings. Because, you know, successes are great. That will take you to the next level. But I'm here to share whatever struggle I had to go through or whatever situations I had faced. And I'm asking you to really work upon this, because you might come across this situation. I'm not saying you will, but some of you might. So ensure that whenever you're getting some offers from new companies, ensure that due diligence is done by you personally. From Dabur, I was picked up by Hindustan Unilever, one of the most promising brand in the FMCG structure, FMCG sector. So they were coming up with a plant in Baddi, which is near Himachal Pradesh. So I was operating from Chandigarh. And Unilever was a brand that everybody aspires to get into. If you go into any colleges, I think the first company really people look forward in management institutes is getting into Unilever. And it's known as one of the companies which manufactures CEO. So if you see most of the CEOs of any organizations in the past, they always used to be from Unilever. So it was known as a company which used to manufacture CEOs. And I was really happy to be part of that organization and was given this opportunity to set up the largest plant of Unilever in Baddi. And we were given very strict deadlines. So naturally, based on my past experience of 3 years, I started redrafting the policies and all of that. And my regional HR head from Delhi walked in one day and he said, what are you up to? So I said, you know, I'm trying to work upon this policy and all of that, and where my team is busy with the recruitment and all of that. One thing he told me is, you should never reinvent the wheel. So I said, what does it mean? So what he said is, Unilever is such a big, large entity, and it has got manufacturing units across India. You have the corporate office, you have the regional offices, and don't you feel that these policies would be available somewhere? So why are you reinventing the wheel? Don't spend your time reinventing the wheel. That is one thing that was a clear message for me. Because in our own ways, we tend to be different from others. We want to show what we can do differently. But what is important is we are wasting company's time, money and all of that. So at times, it's always better that when you get into a company, try to see what is the existing practice. See within the company whether you can pick something from there, and maybe you can tweak those documents. But don't try to reinvent the wheel is one thing that I learned there. The other thing what I learned is, because why Unilever or Hindustan Unilever came to Baddi was, there was fiscal benefit given to companies who started their units in Baddi. At that point of time, Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand were given these fiscal benefits. And most of the companies went ahead and set up their units there. What happened is, all of a sudden, the town started getting immigrant workers, right? Workers started flocking that city. But the city infrastructure was not ready. And that's where Unilever was one company which, you know, the management realized that actually the city is not ready. There are a lot of workers coming into the city. And as a proactive step, they went about and started constructing toilets, you know. And that's where I was part of the core team there. We had to really work hard, because what happened is, there was no houses. Earlier, one room used to accommodate 3 workers. All of a sudden, the landlord started getting greedy. He started having 5-6 people around there. Then workers started complaining and they started falling ill because the hygienic condition was not there, starting with toilets. So immediately, Unilever, along with some of the companies there, formed a core committee, and then we started embarking on the CSR activities. So while we are working on the brilliant basics, you know, you might have the right policies, right conditions in the company. At times, it is also important for an HR to see some of the external factors and see if we can really play a role there. And Unilever gave me that opportunity to really think proactive. So what it means is, I'm giving this example where in that city, Baddi, all of a sudden had this my labors coming in from all parts of the country, and the city was not ready. But company took proactive approach in really leading some of the CSR initiative, which was not pertaining to their unit. This was something outside the unit, okay? And the company took proactive measures to ensure that the living conditions of their employees are better outside. So those were my key learnings there. Besides that, as I said, you know, robust processes was always part of it, because when you grow up, you are supposed to add more skills. You cannot leave any of the skills. So what I'm trying to share is, whatever I shared earlier, my key learnings, that continued. But each company gave me an opportunity to ensure that I'm learning new things. So at Unilever, it was all about being proactive, building strong, robust practices. And at the same time, you know, the key message was, don't reinvent the wheel. If there are policies, processes already available in the system, please try to reach out. If you have great ideas, tweak those documents. But don't try to work from scratch, because it is like waste of time, waste of energy. So that is one takeaway, because when you join big corporates, there would be branch offices, regional offices, other manufacturing units. You need to reach out to them. Okay? Message is clear? My next assignment was with Reliance Retail, again part of the Reliance Group. Reliance had started getting into Reliance business the way they are doing Jio now. Huge plans. The plan was to achieve 1 lakh crore turnover. They were planning to set up stores across the country. There were 16 formats, but within 40 companies. So I started my career there then, and I was responsible for the org design. So my role was to sit with each of the CEOs of these formats and understand their business plan, and then recommend the manpower plan for that complete business unit. What it means is, not only the numbers, but the org structure. Do you need to have a central org structure? Do you need to have a regional org structure? Do you need to have territory sales manager, area sales manager? So I'm just giving these examples to you, because for each business, one size does not fit all. Keep that in mind. And it's important for you all to understand the business plan and plan the org structure or org design, what we call, based on that. That was a huge learning for me, because Reliance, if you really see their plans, it's huge. And if you look at, when you go into any Reliance offices, you will always find Mr. Dhirubhai Ambani's photo. And one key message there, think big, dream big, okay, and leave your dreams. So at Reliance, what I learned is you need to really look at the scale in which they operate and recommend models accordingly. So there, I was lucky enough to work out for all the org structures of various formats within Reliance. There were 16 states, 786 cities that we had to cater to. And we, as an HR team, I was responsible for designing the org structure of each of the formats, the identifying the unique roles in the companies, giving the right titles. So what it also meant is there is a lot of discussions that I need to do with the COEs. Because within HR, there were COEs. So if there was a comp and ben team, I had to engage with them. Because when you are identifying roles, you need to define the pay ranges as well. So my role was all about working with the CEOs, understanding the business plan, coming out with the org structure, based on the org structure, defining whether it should be centralized or it should be decentralized, coming out with mapping each unique role into a great structure, defining the pay ranges. And it was a very, very, you know, unique experience for me because I had never worked at such a large scale. And it involved talking to different stakeholders within Mumbai, across India, meeting the CEOs, and then at the same time, keeping in mind the business line. Because within any retail store, there are perishable item, non-perishable item. There are, you know, gender-wise items also available. So you need to keep all of that in mind. So what I'm trying to highlight to you, in startups or even in matured company, the earlier you are able to understand the business plan, it helps HR, and HR should align its strategy to the business objectives so that we are able to ensure that we are helping the business to achieve its core objectives. Clear? So my key takeaways in Reliance has been, you know, we need to really know what the clear purpose and vision of each company has been. So, you know, you might work in larger entities, but for each business, the vision would be different. So you need to really align that HR strategy to that. At the same time, at Reliance, the scale of operation was mammoth. Pan India, 16 states, as I said. So at times you are put in that situation where you would not have handled. So I was quite lucky to be in that position. And I had great colleagues who really helped me. And because of my learnings in my past company that I need to be effective, I need to communicate, I need to look at external stakeholders and all of that, I was quite successful at Reliance because in a very short stint, I was promoted twice there due to my past learnings. You know, it's through the experience that I was able to really work hard and impress upon the management and ensure that whatever accountability was assigned to me, I was able to execute. The other thing is, you know, one thing what I realized is also we need to think big. It was never, you know, whenever there was a strategy being discussed, it was always how to be India's number one. It was never number two. There was no question of number two at Reliance. Whatever they did, it was always how do we become number one in whatever categories, whatever products, whatever solutions we offer. So basically as an HR, when the business is expecting you to be world number one or India's number one, are you ready from an HR standpoint to attract the best talent, ensure your practices are world class? So all of that needs to be kept in mind. The other thing is basically in 2009, Reliance also went through the recession and they had to really, there was the business pressure and we were asked to lay off some people. And as an HR, we also have faced this situation and of the late this situation has increased. So what you also need to keep in mind is the business would reach out to you as an HR function to see that how we can reduce some headcount numbers. So basically, as an HR, we need to also on one side empathize on the associates who are getting impacted. So you need to plan all of this layoffs quite well because there are certain procedures to be followed. Because if you go through various labor laws, and I think you should learn this when you're going through this part of your 2 years management course, because all of a sudden, if you read newspapers, layoffs are happening all across the companies, most of them, right? But there are questions being asked, are they following the legal way? So most of the companies are not compliant to the practice.
And that is where most of the HR professionals will play an important role. So at Reliance, I think we had great colleagues who really in HR who thought about why can't we outplace these candidates rather than laying them off. So that's one thing which had never struck me, that you know, if a company is having a situation where you need to lay off people, can as an HR proactively engage with other HR colleagues in the country and offer these candidates' profile to them? We took the permission from the, so naturally when you are sharing any information, you cannot just send the CVs. You need to take proper permissions from the management. You need to take the permission of the candidate whose CV you are planning to forward. So I think that was one of the takeaways, because outplacement I had not heard till that point of time, but that's one experience that I got out at Reliance. And that really stands by me till now, because even in my last company, I had to really outplace some of the candidates because the business was not able to carry out those numbers. My next stint was with a US multinational, Sears Holdings Corporation. It's one of the largest retailer. At one point of time, their corporate office was the tallest building in the world. And they planned to set up their IT captive in India. So at Reliance, as I shared with you, you know, I was promoted twice. So while I started with the org design team, I was given the role of HR operations. And then I was also asked to head the IT of Reliance Retail. And that's where my IT stint started. And the CIO from Reliance moved out to join Sears. And he picked me up at Sears India. So that was a captive which was set in Kharadi. So five of us moved out of Reliance. And we came and set up this company in Kharadi. And over a period of 6 years, we scaled that operation to 2,000 people. Now that company was set up in free zone. And we had to really, because as an HR, you need to really ramp up the team to 2,000. You have to ensure your HR policies, practices are in place, because the IT talent is very different. They will question everything and anything that you do. So from an HR standpoint, you need to be very clear in terms of what policies are being rolled out, because they get to know what practices are prevailing in the market and they expect the same from you all. So what it means is when you are setting up the process, because we never carried forward the HR practices of US, everything was set up from scratch. And my role was to really ramp up the team, at the same time set up the HR systems, policies, procedures, and then ensure that the practices were sustained. But at the same time, the challenge was to ensure that the cost was uniform. We did not increase the cost, and that was being closely monitored. So there was a lot of learning there, because Sears India then set up multiple companies. It set up a subsidiary in US. Then it set up a company within outside SEZ. And so in a way, it gave me an exposure to global operation. So that was very key learning. Having said that, what happens is when you're working in a global role, you have to engage with different stakeholders who are operating from different countries. And one thing we also need to keep in mind is we need to respect their culture. Okay. And that's very, very key. So when you are, because as I said, you know, we all are going to work in a global village where you would be sitting here, your manager would be sitting somewhere in Australia or US, or it could be the other way. You would be a manager and you would be managing a global team. So what we also need to keep in mind is basically we are working in a global village and we need to respect the culture of those countries. Because as in HR, to give you an example, in India, we ask everybody their date of birth, gender, aapke mata ji kya kar rahe, pita ji kya kar rahe, and all of that. But globally, you are not supposed to ask personal questions. You know, so you cannot ask if there is some medical disability or personal questions like gender and all of that. So keep that in mind, because it's very important for you all, because if you are planning to make a career in global companies, it's important for you to respect the culture of those companies. And last but most important is after my stint at Sears, I was given a severance, okay, at Sears last year. So these are realities and you need to be ready for this, because all of a sudden you might find that, okay, the management is reaching out to you and they would say that, okay, we cannot afford your cost and Here is a golden handshake, what they call. So are you ready for that? You need to plan your personal careers accordingly. You need to plan your investments, because now a lot of business are going through competition. And you need to ensure that you are managing your personal finances well. So post moving out from Sears, I have started my own HR consulting firm in Dubai. And because that was a market that we looked at where the HR practices were not that matured. And so me and my colleagues started this company 4 months back in Dubai, because that's a market what we thought is where we can go ahead and really implement our knowledge, whatever we have, while we make money, because there is huge opportunity what we realize. And you know, there would be problems. If you really read newspapers, the whole Gulf region is going through crisis. The oil prices, the crude oil was at one point of time $100 per barrel. Today it is 50. Most of the expats from that region is leaving those countries. The government itself is, you know, laying off a lot of people. But we saw an opportunity there, because what we realized is now the most of the GCC's companies would not be able to hire expats, and they will have to look at alternate resources. And that's where they will have to look at capability building, competencies and all of that. And most of these countries are struggling with localizing. What it means is their own native talent is not ready. And they are really working hard to build the competencies and skill of their local talent. And that's where we see as an opportunity that, you know, we can go into that market and really set up our HR and really help the government there. So right now my colleagues there are already working with government. We have signed up some of the clients there, and we are really helping some of the companies to build the capabilities and competencies for their local people out there. So this is in nutshell about my career, my learning. The endeavor was to give you some flavor that, you know, when you pass out, you might get different offers. What is very important for you is to know what type of company you are getting into, what is your role, how you ensure that whatever function you join, how it is aligned to the strategy of the company and helping the company achieve its business objectives. So having said that, basically what I have realized is now some takeaways for you, because what I have shared is all about me. So some things that you need to keep in mind in future is, because today when you read newspapers, we are flooded with bad news, right? There would be news about terrorism, there is news about accidents, deaths, there is news about rapes being carried out. You read all of this, right? You are flooded with those news. And at the same time, you're working in a VUCA world. You know VUCA, right? So it's very unpredictable. You, nobody can predict what is the future is, because we always say in IT, earlier, you know, 10 people's job was replaced by computer. Now 10 computers' job is being replaced by one software. That's the pace of innovation. So somebody is working hard somewhere in other part of the world to replace you. Keep that in mind. And today, it is not only about your company, your city. Any global activity would impact your business. So let's say today we have a situation where North Korea, you know, right? You know or not? So we are in, most of the countries are watching what is happening at North Korea. There is a situation there, and at any point of time, there could be war. Look at India. Two of our neighbors are really ramping up their military force on our borders. There could be a situation there. You might be thinking, how does it impact us? But keep in mind, any global activity in a VUCA world will impact your business operation. So what is important is you need to continuously know what's happening around the world and how that activity or that incident may impact each one of you in your career or your company. And that's very, very key. Having said that, while I am talking a lot of other stuff, but I think once you pass out from this institute and when you are planning to build up your career, I think one few takeaways for you is, I think whatever you do, you need to be happy in what you are doing. And hence, it is always important. Happiness is key. Okay? Yeah. So I knew this, you know, my lecture would be boring, so I need to put this something like this to get you up. Okay? So What I mean to say here is, happiness is not the is the absence of the problems, it's the ability to deal with them. So be passionate, be happy with whatever you're doing. So you'll read one more slide about being passionate. But I think when you plan your career and you get into finance, marketing or HR stream, and when you are building your career, ensure that you personally are happy in whatever you're doing. Okay? Happiness is key, because that's where a lot of positivity comes around, and that really takes you up to the next level. Next takeaway is very, very important, and this is very important nowadays. Health is wealth. We hear about it, but really we don't, you know, how many of you exercise on a regular basis? Okay, so I think this is all for you, because it's very important. We ignore health, but I think most of the corporates are having issues with its workforce, because especially in IT, we have come across situations where associates have started complaining that their fingers are not moving, they have issues with the chairs and all of that. Over a period of time, we got counselors, we got doctors, and what we realized is most of our associates were not taking care of their health. So very important, please ensure that you are spending at least 20 minutes for yourself. Kindly go and exercise. I won't say you should go on a treadmill or a yoga. Whatever you feel good for yourself, or whatever you are comfortable with, I think it's very important. But because this is very important, this you know, if you have health, you can achieve wealth. Okay. Next and most important, be very clear about your goal and purpose of life. Okay. Now, most of us, we typically, when we talk about goal, we say, okay, I want to be a CEO, I want to be a VP, or I want to be a head, and all of that, okay? But I think very important is, first, it starts with your personal life. How do you want to be recognized in your family? How do you want your family to know you as a person better? How do you want to ensure that whatever you're doing, your family is comfortable with that? So what it means is, not only your professional goal, but it is also important for you to have a clear purpose and goal for your family as well. Okay? So this again, you know, so it has to be basically one step at a time, and that really takes you to the journey. But have a clear purpose, that's very, very key. This one, I think all of you need to really have these values. These are very, very important. When you read newspapers, why most of the big corporates are failing, it's because some of their top management people are not ethical. And so I would request you to ensure that over a period of time, you will, when you grow up in your ladder, there would be opportunities for you to earn quick money, but those would be in an unethical way. And hence, this is one of the values that you should all imbibe. As I said a few minutes back, be passionate, whatever you do, because we have this general tendency of comparing ourselves to others, and we actually demotivate ourselves because of that. But I think very important piece is, enjoy what you're doing, okay? So you might say that, okay, I don't like this, you want to get into the other stuff, but whatever you're doing, try to enjoy it, and that's where you become passionate. So try to be passionate in whatever you're doing, it's very, very key. So if you see here, the photographer is so passionate about the photography. Now his stand is burning, his pant is burning down there, but he's still focused and very passionate about the work, what he's doing. This is just an example. Doesn't mean that you need to be in that situation. Okay. The other thing is, you all are going to be management students, and you will be making a lot of presentations to management. Okay. Now, when I'm talking here for last an hour, some of you would have got bored. So what it means is, I am not able to connect with my audience well. Okay? Because there are some great orators who, by the way they talk, are ensuring that all the people in the room are paying attention. So tomorrow, in your managerial role, you would be making a lot of presentations to the senior management. So you need to be very efficient. You need to ensure that the message is given very crisply, and all of the stakeholders in that room understand your message clearly. They also get to know what is expected out of them. So work on this, because it's very important. It's very important. Ensure your presentations are accurate. Ensure, as I said, you know, when we started this presentation, ensure you're 5 minutes before into the boardrooms or any meeting rooms, set up those presentations, because the first impression is the right. And so you will get opportunities to present to different management, but ensure your presentation are crisp. It carries the right message. The stakeholders get to know what is expected of them if they are supposed to give a decision and all of that. So ensure effective communication is very key. And this is something which is personally my favorite. Nowadays, you know, everything is through WhatsApp or through Facebook or through social media. And we would have our brother sitting next in the next room, but we don't make a point to go across and meet and talk. I think personal connect matters. While social media is helping us reach our friends across the borders, but I think what I see is nowadays we wish people on WhatsApp, but why not pick up a phone and talk? So try to get into a habit, because personal connects really matters the most, and you know that's where human relationship comes in. So try to get in. This is something which is my personal favorite, which I say. Next thing is, I have talked a lot about it. Keep in mind that we are working in a global village. We need to respect the culture of different countries, okay? And when you pass out, there would be multinational companies who would come. You would be operating in a different network, but try to ensure that you are respecting the culture of all the countries, okay? Now, when you grow up in your career, it's very important to be humble, okay? So here you see Obama's daughter was personally working as a tent on the tender, one of the pizza joints, right? So what it means is, basically you need to be humble. And you know, in some parts of our country, you know that, what is written there? Tu janta hai? That's typical all about us, right? But I think more and more we are working in a global environment, it's important. When we move up in our career, it's also important to be humble. And I also have another snap where this guy is the son of a largest diamond manufacturing company in Gujarat. And actually, he did not divulge his identity, and he went to southern part, he went to Kerala, and he worked like a normal human being. He's a multi-billionaire, okay? Multi-billionaire son. But his father wanted to ensure that, you know, he is humble in his career. So he said, okay, you go as in your own name into that any different part of the country and see how the world is, you know, what is there on ground. And it's very important for us to be humble. And these are some examples, because, you know, in your career, you will make money, you will grow. But it's very imperative that we be humble. Last point, last takeaway, which is very important. While we grow, it's also important to be associated. We need to know that we have to give it back to the society. So it could be in different, it could be through financial, it could be through going and teaching in some municipality schools, being helping the poor, donating the clothes. But I think get into that habit, because as India, we most of our population is below the poverty line. Okay, a large chunk of them are below the poverty line. So if you can go back and give it to the society, I think it would be a great stuff. That's all I had to say, and I hope you all have a bright future and you all can do achieve what you aspire for. So yes, wishing you all a great career in future. But I think the next 2 years are going to be what I call the strong. You need to lay a strong foundation, because what you learn in next 2 years will decide your future. So ensure that, you know, I have shared some of the practices, and I think when I talk to your faculty, they have lined up a lot of series. We people like us will come and just speak and go. But I think it's all up to you. And I personally feel that you all can do it. And here's wishing you all the best. And have a great evening ahead. Thank you.
Now, the house is open for question and answer session.
Yeah, please.
Good evening, sir. My name is Madhur. Sir, my question is, as an employee, can I argue with the HR over certain issues and decisions? Or it would spoil. Can you elaborate on these aspects?
So again, you know, very good question, because as I said, you need to keep in mind that whichever company you get into, it will be at a different maturity level. Some are startups, some are matured, some would be world leaders and all of that. However, when you really see, most of the companies are getting into this HR mode where there is transparency which is brought in. And definitely, I'm not saying all HR departments would like this question. Definitely, some of them would not, because as I said, you know, each company are at a different maturity level. So you need to really analyze what this company is all about. But if you really ask most of the MNCs or most of the leading organizations in India, definitely they look forward for inputs from employees. And if you see my second slide, I think I talked about customer orientation. So in a company, for HR, employees are its customers. So it has to listen to its customers. Having said that, different HR at a different maturity level as well. So, you know, don't go tomorrow and argue with. So you need to understand the practices of certain companies and also see if they are open for such ideas. So to be frank, you will have to gauge it yourself, because that's where you need to carry out your due diligence, what company you are getting into, how they are doing financially, what are the people practices, how are the long-term visions and all of that. So I hope I have answered your question, because, you know, startups would be very different. But in a global this thing, there are a lot of portals where you can share your suggestions and all of that. There are town halls which happen in most of the companies. So definitely they invite question and answers, and I think you can share your inputs. Yes.
Good evening, sir. Good evening. Sir, as we all saw, you have a great professional career. Sir, you said that we should conduct due diligence before joining any company, either also in professional and personal life. So I would like to know, what are the steps which you follow for due diligence, apart from conducting, apart from checking financial status through Ministry of Corporate Affairs and Employment Provident Fund of any company?
No. So a couple of things. Because as I said, you know, you all guys are lucky. For me, my every next company has been due to my ex-bosses. You know, they have always pulled me into my new company. But having said that, earlier part of my career, I had never carried out due diligence. I learned it very hard, and that's why I wanted to share that with you all. What I mean here is, you need to know the financials of the company. So if you go onto Google and you just type a company name, it talks about the financial statements. And if you just type a company name, you go to, nowadays most of the candidates, we realize that they go to the Glassdoor. And those are the forums they go and see that, you know, when they come to interview itself, they share these insights with us. Hey, we heard about this company, is it right, wrong? So what I'm trying to share here is, most of the information today is available on social media. But if you are part of a recruitment function, I always say that we are the advocates for the company. And at the same time, the candidate does not know much of the company. So it's very important for us to be transparent with them. Because nowadays the candidates are really smart, and what they do is, they check with the colleagues who are working there as well. If you are going through a consultant, you can definitely ask more information from the consultant, because the consultants are getting their consultancy phase for this work, what they are supposed to do. They are supposed to educate the candidate and inform them about the companies, whatever it is, the role, the company performance, its long-term vision and all of that. As I said, you know, if you just go to Google, there are different platforms or different websites where all the information of the company is pretty much available. So naturally, you have to look at the security features, the long-term plans, basically, is there any cases going against these companies and all of that. Okay?
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir.
My question is for you is, going through your career history, you worked in many sectors, so just wanted to ask, is there some strategic approach that you followed, or if yes, then is this a good approach to follow?
No, it's not, because if you really see, you know, it varies. Because now if you look at the way the companies release an advertisement, they would always prefer a person from the same industry. I was quite lucky enough, because as I said, you know, if you really see some of the words that I have highlighted, if you are brilliant in the work what you are doing, so I was in HR, so I was very good in my labor laws. At the same time, I was very good at aligning the HR strategy to the business objective. I did not go and start something which I had done in my previous company, because as I said, one size does not fit all. So before you go for an interview itself, you need to know about that company. As I was sharing with her, we need to carry out due diligence. It starts from right from the day a consultant called you for a position, or you plan to apply for a position. You need to carry out those due diligence. What the business is into, what is its business objective, what is its long-term plan. And then you need to also see that what value you will bring on to that company. Because when you go to for an interview, it's not a one-way process. As a candidate, you also can ask many questions. If you have, there are some questions in your mind, you need to go and ask. But at the end of the day, as I said, you know, what they look at is, if they are hiring you for a particular position, they are trying to see that you are bringing in the right technical and the behavioral competencies that are required for that role. So your brilliant basics is very, very important. Having said that, aligning your core function to the business objectives, it cannot be to your individual this thing. You know, I want to start an assessment center because I have heard about it, I have read about it. But is the company ready for that? So what it means is, we might come across, your colleagues would be working in different companies, they may share, you know, in this company this is what is happening. And you might think, okay, let me implement that. But what is very important is your company ready for, is your company matured for the practices that you are planning to implement? So all of that depends upon the company what you get into, whether it's a startup, whether it's a company which is already 5 years old, 10 years old, or it is quite matured. So in depending upon the maturity of the company, you should implement the practice, and at the same time, you should also see that whether these practices, because we always say one thing, you know, before implementing any policy process, try to take some dipstick with your colleagues across different functions. They will give you best input. And that's how you go about it. Okay?
Good evening, everyone. I, Priyam Paul, student manager, Sri Balaji Society, would like to extend my warm gratitude towards Mr. Santosh Panicker, sir. Sir, your journey from campus to corporate has lit a lead of positivity, effectiveness, efficiency, and clarity of thoughts among us. Sir, in today's session, your valuable thoughts on happiness is the key, health is wealth, goals and purpose, values and ethics, and many more will surely benefit the student managers in their upcoming corporate world. Sir, your charismatic persona has enhanced our attitude to accomplish the impossibilities in our life ahead. Thank you. Have a great evening ahead.